But one thing I want to talk about is this concept in general of student debt relief. I see a lot of people pushing back on that, obviously, particularly mostly Republicans pushing back saying, why should I have to pay your school bills? Why do I need to pay for you to go to college? It was your choice to go to college. Why do I have to pay for it? Well, because it was your choice not to go to college. It was your choice not to further your education. It was your choice to not contribute to our society. Building a strong first world nation requires world-class education. You need engineers, you need plumbers to give you the indoor sewage, yes, you know, to give you your toilets. We need engineers so that you can have electricity in your homes. You need people, you know, engineers for your cars, for your roads, for bridges, for building buildings. You need architects. You need doctors to provide you medicine. You need nurses. You need teachers. You need all of these educated people in order for you to live in a first world nation. If we all had the attitude of, I'm going to choose to not get educated because I don't want to have to pay for it. I'm not stupid enough to go take out that big loan or get that big bill. Then imagine what America would look like. It would be a third world nation. You have the benefit of living in a first world nation because so many people did go and become educated and did decide to contribute to this society. The biggest sham with the big banks has been the rising cost of education. There used to be a time in the ancient days when educating the next generation was considered a privilege, an honor, and even something that was mandatory. You needed to. You must educate the next generation to further society. The wise elders would go and happily teach the youth everything they know until they no longer could teach them anything else. And hopefully the youth would learn so much and they would advance and they would learn even more. And then they would take their knowledge and they would pass it on to the next generation. And it used to be something that you did without charging. It was something that was free because it's necessary to continue society. And through time, this whole idea became that, and really where it sprouted from was this, it was the rich and the elites wanting to remain wealthy and elite and wanting to keep the poor people down. And one way that they decided to keep the poor people down was by charging poor people to become educated, because they knew if they became educated, then they would become competition. And they didn't want that. I mean, if you are the elites and you're just a small segment of society and only your class of people are the doctors, the engineers, the lawyers, the scientists, and you've got all these poor farmers and mechanics and people, you know, and iron steel workers and bakers, you've got all these people working those real blue collar jobs. And you know that the doctors, the lawyers, the engineers, the scientists, they get paid 10 times more than the blue-collar workers. You want your children, if you're the elites, you want your children to go and take over your medical practice or your law practice or your whatever, right? And it used to be where generation after generation, they would take over the job of their fathers. And that's the way that it was. And then there were some kids that got a little too ambitious for the elites. And they said, you know what? I want to get an education. I don't want to be a baker like my father. I want to go and become a doctor. I have a passion for medicine. I love healing. I want to become a doctor. So I want to go and do that. And what it used to be was that the father, the doctor, would teach his son. And that was the way knowledge was passed down from generation to generation. It was gifted. And then suddenly the person, well, shoot, if you want to, you know, become a doctor and compete against my child, well, you're going to have to pay for your education. This was a way to discourage the working class from elevating themselves, from rising up. This was a way to discourage the poor farmers from sending their kids off to elevate them to a different class level. This was the way to keep the poor in their place, was to charge for an education. And through time, so not only was it a way, a mechanism for the elites to remain elite and the wealthy to remain their class and to keep people in their place, it also grew into this, the banks saw real serious opportunities. So once we already established, so the banks didn't really start to take advantage of this until it was well established that the elites would force the poor to pay for their college educations and the rich could afford it. It was easy, right? So college is the same price no matter which class you came from. Now, we nowadays have some controls on that, right? We have, you can get grants and student loans, but the loans is what we're going to talk about. So, but no matter what, the price of tuition is the same for everybody if you're going to go to a university. And if you're rich, it's easy to pay for. And if you're poor, it's not so easy to pay for. And oftentimes, if you're poor, you're just discouraged from going because you cannot afford that bill. Well, after this system had been set up for a while, the banks started to get greedy. And what we're now seeing is the increasing price, the rise of tuition cost continues to go up and up and up and up, even though the buildings are the same, even though the knowledge is the same, right? So mathematics are mathematics are mathematics, English literature is English literature is English literature. A lot of these things remain the same, but the price of the education continues to go up. And it's because the banks and the universities saw an opportunity. The banks said to the universities, look, you can effectively raise your tuition because guess what? We'll give the students the loans. So the universities thought, oh, so instead of charging $5,000 a semester, I can charge $35,000 a semester because the kids will have no choice but to pay for it because they want to get educations from these top institutions where they can get jobs in at the top of their field. So the banks encouraged this increase of tuition because they said to the universities, we'll give the students the loans. And then the banks lobbied the government and said, now make these federally backed secured loans. That way, students absolutely can take out these loans, and we know for sure we're going to get our money. And so the government said, okay. So they fell for this ridiculous trap. And now you've got students going into an enormous amount of debt because the banks are taking advantage of the situation and the universities are taking advantage of the situation and the banks have lobbied our government. So a student walks out of debt in $60,000, $80,000, $100,000 of debt. If they've gone off to medical school or law school, you're looking at $200,000 of debt. And meanwhile, the wages are not increasing at the same rate that the education costs are going up. So yes, will they be making more money than your average baker, right? Will the doctor make more money than the baker? Maybe, right? Maybe not. It just kind of depends. Where are they practicing medicine? Is the baker of a really big bake shop where they're selling bread to every single grocery store in America? If that's the case, then they're making way more money than that doctor. And but at the end of the day, the whole idea of education being a cost is a scam. It was a scam from the beginning for the elites to remain elite, for the wealthy to remain wealthy, to ensure that the people in the lower class didn't try to elevate themselves. How dare they try to weasel their way into the upper class? And it was a way for the banks to run off with more money because the bank makes money when you go into debt. That's how banks make money. They need you to go into debt. And when they find opportunities to put you in more debt, they encourage it. So the house prices have gone way up. And not relative, not in line with inflation. Housing prices have gone way up just because the banks said, we'll give you the loans. We'll continue to give you the loans. So as long as you're willing to take out a loan, we're going to give it to you. And now that means that there's more competition on the market for homes, which means the values of the prices of the homes go up. Same thing with education. They said to the universities, hey, listen, charge whatever you want. We'll give out the loans and we'll put these students, as they start their lives in society, we'll put them in 30 years of mortgage worth of debt just for getting an education while they benefit and better our society on top of it. So we're going to bankrupt these students before they even get out there into the light of day. And they're building our society. They're making our society better. And yet we're still going to charge them for it. That doesn't make any sense at all. Everybody should be for student debt forgiveness. And then after we do student debt forgiveness, because what's going to happen is rather than all that money going to the banks, which they shouldn't be collecting on anyway, that money will go right back into the economy. If you are a small business owner, you're going to get more money. You're going to see an increase in business because somebody doesn't have to pay $1,000 a month to student debt. They instead can take their $1,000 and spend it in the economy. So everybody should be for student debt forgiveness. And then secondarily after that, we need to eradicate the cost of higher education. It really should be free. In Germany, education is considered a human right. They don't charge anybody for education. Even if you, as a non-German, go to Germany and enroll yourself in university, you will not be charged. They don't charge anybody. They believe it's a human right. And because of it, Germany is rapidly catching up to us. They are increasing their rate of gaining patents, and scientific advancement is much faster than the growth rate of the United States. But we really, really, really need to be focusing a lot more on educating our population, keeping our nation as strong and as healthy as possible. One analogy I like to use is a high school football team. So imagine that there's two high school football teams, and one high school football team provides a really state-of-the-art workout facility. On top of it, they use, so they've got a state-of-the-art workout facility. They have nutrition counseling and sports medicine. The other high school football team says, we don't have that. You're going to have to ask your parents to provide you with a gym membership and nutrition counseling and sports medicine. And because of it, the other high school that doesn't provide it, they can only, about 30 to 40% of their teammates can afford that. And has the extra resources and the extra funds to give themselves that extra level of training. When those two high school football teams meet on the field, which team would you bet on winning? You're going to bet on the team that every single team member has been able to get a world-class, you know, state-of-the-art training. You know, they get to go and train every day in a state-of-the-art training facility. They get proper nutrition counseling to keep their bodies strong. You know, nobody's getting chubby on that team. They also have sports medicine. If they get injured, they can immediately treat it effectively so their best players remain in the top, in tip-top shape. That team is going to win on that field time after time. And maybe once in a while, the team that doesn't provide that will win. But if that team that doesn't provide it is going up against teams that do provide it time after time after time after time after time, it is more likely they're going to lose more often than they're going to win. And that is how we should view our nation. If you are a, now I know the pushback comes from Republicans, so listen, if you are a patriot, if you love America, you want to make America great again, this is how you do it. You invest in your fellow Americans. You say, we have to be a strong team. We need to be the strongest out there. And the only way we're going to be strong is if we keep our population healthy, if we keep our population educated.